Good afternoon and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Phil Bronstein, still, I think, of the San Francisco Chronicle, and I'm your moderator for today's program. And it's now my pleasure to introduce today's distinguished, very distinguished guest, as you all know, veteran Washington journalist and author of the new book, Listen Up, Mr. President. I could talk for some time about Helen Thomas's more than 30 honorary degrees, her pioneering role as the first woman officer of the then exclusively boys fraternity of the National Press Club, the first woman officer of the White House Correspondents Association, first woman member, then president of the Gridiron Club. In fact, her many, many firsts since she began her career in journalism at age 22, where she was earning $17.50 a week. That's $17.50. After a brief but unsuccessful career as a waitress. And then joining United, their loss
it's
our
It's hard
gain.
To hear your obituary.
And then she joined United Press International in 1943. But what is really key to appreciating and understanding the critical role that Helen Thomas has played in our lives and our culture is that she, more than anyone, any other single person, cumulatively day in and day out, has held the most powerful person in the world accountable. And she's done so always understanding that she represents right there in the front row of the White House briefing room, never ignored, although nine presidents have tried. She represents all of us, and that's something journalists today don't always remember, that our most important constituency isn't our competitors or fellow journalists or powerful people in institutions, but it is the public we're here to serve. And Helen Thomas has not only clearly kept that in mind during the many years she's been on the job, she's done it more aggressively, and more consistently, and more without fear or favor than any journalist I can think of. She said recently that presidents deserve to be questioned irreverently, and they need to be brought down to size. It said we're supposed
to... I wrote all this myself.
It said... Yeah, I wish you had, because then it would be better. But okay, we're supposed to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable, and Helen Thomas has made sure that no president since JFK has gotten completely comfortable, which should make the rest of us feel better. She's the author of several other books, including the national bestseller Front Row at the White House, which I have a well-worn copy of in front of me. Please join me in welcoming Helen Thomas.
Thank you. Thank you. After that, everything is downhill.
No. Now the fun starts. I have to say, as honored as I am to be here interviewing you today, I am equally relieved that you're not interviewing me. There's plenty in the news to talk about, and I'm sure you have a lot to say about it. I'm proud to say we're now colleagues at Hearst, sort of colleagues. I'm here in San Francisco, here at Hearst in Washington. Mm-hmm. You told CNS News, I think, not too long ago, that not even Richard Nixon tried to control the press the way President Obama is trying to control the press. Is that an accurate quote, and can you talk a little bit about that?
Not totally accurate, but close. The thing is, the Obama administration came in really thinking that they could tell every reporter the night before that they were going to be called on and so forth. And even though I don't believe they asked what they were going to ask, they certainly got the message in a way of to behave and so forth. So I think that it was very bad, and I hope we've pulled them up short now that they don't inform reporters the night before that they're going to be called on.
Well, you in fact confronted Gibbs, the press secretary, and you told him, I'm amazed that you people who call for openness and transparency are doing this, that these things are prepackaged, telling reporters the night before they're going to be called on. Do you think really that these press secretaries have consciences about this kind of thing?
No. I don't think you talk about Washington and conscience in the same breath.
You have advised in your new book, well, you have a lot of advice for, I mean, it seems like on one hand there'd be a limited audience for this book because it's advice to presidents, presumably future and present presidents.
I'm going to give him a copy.
No, good. But you say that lying is bad. And I think we all know that from growing up and learning that from our families. But most presidents do it, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
And has this president been any exception?
They walk around it. You know, they don't think they're lying. They're able to spin and mislead and so forth. And they say, I don't want to speculate and so forth. And you hope for a straight answer and very seldom get one.
Also, I mean, you've covered presidents who have outright lied. I mean, you've talked in several of your books about Bill Clinton being one, Richard Nixon being another. One often doesn't think of the two of them.
But they pay a heavy price for that.
What price did Clinton pay? Because I know you referred to him as having been victimized, presumably unfairly.
From the moment he stepped into the Oval Office, I think that the ultra-right never let up. They targeted from the moment he stepped in and made him always the victim of investigation constant. For 8 years, he couldn't breathe.
But where does that put you? You're sitting there front row at the White House for daily briefings and sort of most significantly for the public, for presidential press conferences. So you're sitting there feeling that this guy has been victimized. And I know you've said before that you kept all the adjectives out of your work because you didn't want to give away your own particular feelings. But so is there not an adjustment that you make if you feel that a president, is there anything you can do?
I feel every president has to be accountable and they have to be understand that they are representing the American people, representing our country, and I think we have to pile on in a way because we're the last frontier. We're the only group in society who can question a president very directly. Everybody would like to question the president. We have that great privilege, and we shouldn't blow it.
And how do you think? I mean, you're there, and you've been there through nine presidents, and I looked through some clips the other night, and you are as aggressive now as you were with JFK. So you've been doing
that.
Ten presidents, sorry. Ten, right, Obama. And factual. You've been consistent. What about your colleagues in the White House press corps in general?
Well, I think they let the country down in the run-up to the war with Iraq, invasion of Iraq, and under many falsehoods that President Bush was dispensing. I think that betrays the country. So I wasn't very respectful of my colleagues in that period. I do think they've gotten tougher and more aggressive. I think you can be aggressive. You also should be courtesy and respect the office, but you don't have to bow and scrape for any president.
Yeah, I read, I think in front row at the White House that you had said once to Helmut Kohl, you know, who won World War II? So you clearly were not worrying about bowing and scraping there.
Yeah, and he said something. I was walking out. I said, "Who won the war?"
Now, this is a great book. If you haven't read it, Front Row at the White House, you really should. And it was a national bestseller. What struck me, one of the many things that struck me, though, was how tough you talk about having to be as a White House correspondent, and certainly you in particular as a woman who broke a lot of barriers. And without fear or favor, covering presidents. But if you look at the pictures, you know, it's fascinating to see.
I'm in awe. My mouth is dropping out. My eyes are widening. This president of the United States.
They're singing happy birthday to you.
So I'm not that jaded.
but they're singing happy birthday to you. Nancy Reagan preempted an announcement of your engagement. You know, it's presidents with their arms around you.
Yes. They hate me.
Well, that explains their psychology, which is understandable given that they have to worry about you. But I'm really fascinated about your psychology relative to this. In other words, how do you really keep from being seduced by the aura, by the power, by, in some cases, though not others, the charm, the immense charm, the idea, the thing that leaves your mouth agape when you see your picture taken. How do you avoid that?
They have their job, and I have mine. That's what I feel. I feel that no matter how nice they are, I mean, the real question of the day is what's going on and what are they going to do about our country and the world.
Well, that's okay, but again, you're there. I mean, you talk very proudly about having, there's a favorite restaurant of yours in Washington, and you have your seat there. I mean, you are an institution in Washington. And I you know, you see a lot of these other institutions really becoming...
I like it.
You like it? Which part? Well, I was going to ask you, because you've said about presidents, they both hate and they love the attention.
That's right.
Is that also true of you?
Of course.
And so the balance...
My ego is swelling.
There's a question here from the audience. Which president have you... It says you've served. Well, you haven't served any president, which is part of the point. But do you admire and respect the most and the least?
President Kennedy was my favorite because I felt he was the most inspired. I felt he understood war because he'd been in war. He was a man of peace. He signed the first nuclear test ban treaty, created the Peace Corps, and he said we're going to land men on the moon. And we thought he was really out of his mind and so forth, but we did it. He didn't live to see it. And he invited the first class of astronauts to the White House with their wives for an informal dinner, and he said to them, Kennedy said to them, do you think we could land on the moon? They said, sure, absolutely. You never say no to a president. When they left, they said, is this guy nuts? Land on the moon?
But there's also a story in your book about giving JFK a bit of a break at a press conference, that you found him struggling on a particular question, and that you said, that's when the famous, now famous phrase, right. Thank you, Mr. President. And he looked at you, because I saw the film of it, and he looked at you, he said, thanks, Helen, you know.
Thank you.
Thank you, Helen, right. And it just strikes me that would you have done that for Richard Nixon?
Yes. I'll do anyone a favor if they're president.
There's a story you tell about Nixon going in to make his speech, his resignation speech, I think was when he said, pray for me.
It was his last speech to the nation, and he knew everything was over and he was about to resign, and you could only feel total sympathy for him. So I ran into him, I was rushing back to the press room to hear his speech, and he looked so forlorn. He was walking from the executive office building across the street to the White House. And I said, good luck, Mr. President. And he said, pray for me.
So was it, there must have been, because Nixon
very
was not...
Very poignant moment, and you could only feel sadness.
Because he was not otherwise generally a sympathetic character.
He's greatly human, as we all are.
Now, one part, the last part of the question was which president you respect the least? Would you want to answer that question?
The what?
Which president you admire and respect the least? You're a columnist now, so...
The last one.
I'm going to leave that perfect answer right where it is.
I had to tell you that during the height of the Watergate question, and I was called, President Nixon complimented me on getting an appointment, a promotion to bureau chief. I was head of two people, I think, big deal. It was a big deal for me, but anyway, he complimented me at the start of a news conference, and I came with a very tough, you might say, loaded question on Watergate. And I was really in a dilemma. Do I ask this question? What can the American people think of me? Here the president being so nice, and I'm going to slap him in the face. And I thought of my peers, and I think that flattery will get you everywhere. So I asked the question. I felt very bad, though. ambivalent.
Fortunately, not bad enough, not to ask
it. Right, not bad enough.
You
diabolical.
You say in your new book that, quote, unreasonably high expectations inevitably lead to disappointment for presidents and their public. And you say the almost inevitable failure to meet unreasonable expectations is often what makes a president miserable. I read that and I can't help but think of our current president, about the expectation levels. And I'm wondering whether you see that leading to the disappointment that you talk about generally here.
I sure do. I think, you know, when he was elected, he was walking on water. And now we find out he's quite human. And I really think that great presidents have great consciences. They really care. And I think he certainly has that. But I think he lacks courage to do the right thing because of politics.
So it's not, I mean, because he's certainly been slammed a little bit for indecisiveness, but you think it's another issue altogether.
In every way, but I do think he needs to be bolder. He has to stick to his guns, especially on health care.
And one of the things that's been, you're talking about, you've mentioned intentions, basically, when it comes to President Obama. One of the things that's been said about the controversy over the Nobel Prize is, you know, he's getting it for intentions, not for actual performance. Do you agree with that?
What was the question?
The Nobel Prize, the Peace Prize. Is he getting it for good intentions?
Yes.
Which is one, as opposed to actual...
I don't think he has accomplished enough to deserve it. But at the same time, it's a great thing to try to live up to.
Well, it sounds like you don't think that he's necessarily able to live up to it.
Oh, no. I do think he's got three more years to work for peace and get out of Iraq, get out of Afghanistan, get out of these wars. He has to work for peace and bring it about. I mean, it's a big burden for him now.
Do you think in a way that he's been a little bit of a victim of his own success as a character, as an individual, as a personality, as a very charismatic, likable guy? I mean,
There's no such thing as an instant president. They have no idea of what they're facing and how much their decisions will impact on the whole world. I think it really must be a great eye-opener for them and keep a lot of people sleepless at night. I think that he doesn't understand, none of them do, what they've taken on. But I don't waste my sympathy on them. They ask for it. I'm so callous, aren't I?
Well, you know, I wouldn't say callous, but it's worked for you very well. another question from the audience. What do you think about the proliferation of anonymous sources in the, it says print media, but I don't think it's only in the print media.
Proliferation?
Of anonymous sources in the media.
I think sometimes you have to rely on them because you can't get the information any other way. You would love to have someone's name attached to everything you write, but that's impossible. I've had presidents try to hide under guys, many of them. A senior American official of the highest. On Kissinger once, they wanted him on background, meaning you couldn't use his name. So I said, a senior American official with a thick German accent. said today.
Did you get any blowback for that?
They had his picture on it.
Do you think the journalists of today, is another audience question, are more likely to look for the scandal instead of the real story? This sort of goes to a deeper question about the quality of journalism and what's happening with journalism today.
Well, I think scandal has always been very provocative, and it's always been news in a way, especially if it's attached to a public figure. so you can't avoid it. I mean, even if the mainstream press wanted to pass up that kind of a story of privacy, if the tabloids run it, then you have to jump on it. Otherwise, you'd be accused of covering up. So it's always a little more titillating to have that kind of a story than what's happening. Because war stories now are all numbers. They aren't even people. They aren't even human anymore. There's been so much censorship, not showing the photographs of coffins and so forth. They were able to sanitize war in terms of our consumption. So you don't really see the reality of the horror that we've inflicted. Thank you. Thank you. We should fight for much more exposure of what we do in this world.
Are you worried that the level of that exposure, I mean, we were talking a little bit before the event today about how much the diminution of money that's gone into journalism. There was an estimate today, $1.6 billion has been lost in the cutbacks that have gone on in journalism organizations. And I'm just wondering, this must concern you greatly.
Very much. I think I can't live without a newspaper, and I don't think any of us should. There's nothing like having a newspaper in your hand. And you read so much more. It engulfs you. You read a lot more than you intended to read, and you learn a lot more.
Well,
great educator every day.
I'm heartened to hear you say that because I work for a newspaper, of course. Although I did see at the beginning of your book, there was a Q&A 95, I think, here in San Francisco. And a reporter for the Chronicle said, well, you know, was it hard for women starting in journalism as you did, making their way in journalism? And you said, what are you, from Mars?
Well, that goes for all the professions for women, except maybe in World War II when they were drafting every young man who had a pulse. He was going to war, and then women began to fit into these jobs. And then we were all fired after World War II. They didn't realize the growing pains of our country and the place for women, so they had to crawl right back. The suffragists marched 70 years. They chained themselves to the White House fence, went to jail, and so forth, to get the vote.
So what were the...
Not till 1920.
So as, again, you know, a pioneer in all these areas, whether it's these sort of good old boy events that had gone on historically in Washington, I mean, there must have been moments of doubt that you had. There must have been moments of, you know, I wouldn't say fear, because you don't strike me as a person who has much of that. But certainly
you'd be surprised. I cry a river.
What's the thing you've been most afraid of in
What's
your career?
The thing? Making big mistakes, hurting a lot of people. I think you can do that. I mean, you have a big weapon in your hand when you are a reporter. And I think you have great trepidation of hurting people, hurting reputations, ruining lives.
Which sort of raises another point. You know, you talked about tabloids and scandal, and you've written about Bill Clinton and that scandal, and you've written a little bit less about JFK, or that I've seen. Maybe you have written and spoken about it. But it does seem clearly the standards are very different in the days of JFK. But you have said that it should be an issue and it should be reported on if it affects your job. It's still unclear to me, I think, because it's hard to sift fact from fantasy and conspiracy theories. In the case of JFK, whether, you know, his extracurricular activities may have gotten in the way in some respects of him doing his job. And one wonders, I mean, there was a lot of positive press about JFK, his family, Carolyn's pony, John under the desk, Jacqueline Kennedy, very extraordinarily elegant woman. Whether there was a sort of a family values aspect to that of the time that was contradicted by his behavior. So do you think, in retrospect, that it was the right thing to do for people to look the other way on those issues with JFK?
I think the world has changed. From the 60s on, a whole culture of the nation changed. People live together. There's no big horror about it and so forth. All of our culture has changed, and the morals basically considered what were public morals. I think in terms of JFK, the rumors were big, of course, but there was the golden rule that if a public man did something that impacted on his official duties and responsibilities, then you wrote about it. Otherwise, it was his private life and no man's land. Now it's changed. Even if I wanted it to change, it nothing. I mean, everybody's wired, everybody's on camera, there's no place to hide. So it's a very different world, and I think you have to take it as it is.
I guess they couldn't ignore, was it Wilbur Mills who ended up in the tidal basin? That was harder to ignore.
It was hard to ignore. Running after a fan dancer.
Well, the company you choose. So do you think that's strictly a bad thing, strictly a good thing that there's this ubiquity?
I think truth is the best thing, and I think it's very tough. Tough on a public figure. I used to say if you want to run for public office, you should decide at the age of 5. And live accordingly. Yeah.
You should bump that up to 12 at least. We've talked about your pioneering roles in the Gridiron Dinner and the White House Correspondents Association, which has a very well-known, now celebrity-studded annual dinner. And you've talked about how you think that's a healthy outlet for journalists and for leaders, presidents and others, that humor is really a good thing, that it helps everyone, you know, blow off some steam and shows that the leaders are human also. But it's also been criticized, all these events have been criticized as just too chummy between the press and powerful people in Washington. Do you think that there is a problem there? There is
no,
an aspect?
No, I haven't been that chummy.
Not you, obviously not you personally, but...
And I don't think, I mean, more you can find out what's going on from president, so be it. I mean, it would be good. I don't feel there's any big damage there. You can always tell who's in the tank and who isn't. Depending on that.
How are we doing percentage-wise on in-the-tank reporters? are we in trouble yet?
Yes.
Your friend Abigail Van Buren, dear Abby, once said of you, "No one is to the left of Helen Thomas." is that true?
She is my friend. She used to tell the story about getting a letter from a woman who said that two women live next door, and sometimes she thinks they're Lebanese. And she used that on me.
But you have now, you've made a transition since you've been at Hearst. You now write a column, you can do commentary, and you have what I think San Franciscans consider to be a great badge of honor, and that Bill O'Reilly called you a far-left pinhead. And you've said, "I'm dying to find another liberal in the press. Where are they?"
That's right. Before.
So how is that? First of all, Abigail Van Buren was obviously joking to some extent, but do you consider yourself, are you happy to sort of come out as a progressive, as a political liberal? How would you describe your politics now that you're able to actually use?
Well, everybody knew him as a big loudmouth liberal before that, but I couldn't put it in my copy.
Right.
Now I can tell the world, and yes, I'm enjoying it. I wake up... Well, when the editor first looked at my copy, it said, "This is wire service desk. You know, where is the edge? Where is it?" I said, "What do you mean?" They said, "Your opinion." I said, "My opinion?" So I say, now I wake up every morning and say, "Who do I hate today?" That's how you write a column. You can't like, well, once in a while you can like something, not often.
And so when you woke up today...
I thought of you.
Well, fortunately, you do that every day, so I only have 24 hours. Who was the best? you talked about managed news, and I think the phrase started maybe in the Kennedy era or after that, but who was the best at managing news in terms of administrations?
Reagan, the Reagan people. They, you know, they picked the story of the day that you had to focus on. They knew that he would be able to perform so well on that, and everything else was extraneous.
And Obama's not doing so well in this regard, managing the news. I mean, you've suggested here that they've tried, but not been that successful.
They tried. I think that reporters are now getting a lot tougher.
Here's a question from the audience. What do you think about Obama's advisors? In your book, you quoted one that Obama said to his advisors. You're quoted that Obama said to his advisors, "Tell me the right thing to do, and I'll sell it." Which doesn't sound like a guy necessarily is going to instill you with confidence about, as you say, his courage, but are they telling him the right thing to do is the question here.
I think his advisors are good. And they're also basically new to Washington. I think they're learning, too. I think that there's no such thing as bipartisanship. And I think that he's trying too hard to find his way with the other side. Stop catering to the Republicans because they're not going to help him.
Sure. You've had a few run-ins with Gibbs, the press secretary. Some of them pretty famous on YouTube, actually, where you said that you wanted his conscience to bother him.
Yes.
Do you think it does?
Yes.
Enough?
Because after that, he started asking every reporter about their conscience. No.
Well, actually, reporters should have one, I think, right?
Yes,
yeah.
They should.
Politicians, no. There's a question from the audience.
I don't think we're superior, but I do think we are dedicated to truth.
Do you think that that journalists, in a way, in recent decades even, have sort of lost their way? I mentioned at the beginning that you never seem to forget who it is you're serving. You're serving the public. But particularly with the advent of kind of celebrity journalists and the fogging of the line between opinion and fact, attempt to get at the fact, do you think that that's really become a problem for journalists?
I do. I think it's great to be recognized, your ego swells and so forth. But I think it puts you in a dilemma also. If you want to be liked, I don't think any of us ever went into journalism to be loved. We know it's exactly non sequitur. But I think that whole business of becoming a celebrity, you expect to play ball. And I don't think we should do that. It's very, very difficult.
Here's a question from the audience. We remember your reaction to Bush 2's becoming president. And the question is, what are your prescient words regarding Barack Obama? I think you've provided some, but I'm curious, this prompts me to ask you what you thought of George W. Bush, because clearly he was not politically aligned with your perspective. He didn't leave a wildly popular president. We're here in San Francisco, where he probably was even slightly less popular. So what was your personal view of George W. Bush?
My personal view was that he could not rise to the stormy present, that he hung an albatross of torture around our necks for American people to be tarnished with this whole business of torture. How can we ever overcome that? Taking our civil liberties away under the guise of everything was because of 9/11. Lying to us about the arsenal that Iraq didn't have, ties to Al-Qaeda, weapons of mass destruction, a threat from a third world country against the world's only military superpower. I felt deception is a terrible thing. The American people can take the truth. They can handle it, but they can't take lies.
So there was a question, really, during, I think, the Bush presidency, particularly in that period when it was clear that a lot of these things that you were talking about were illusions, at least, that were sold to the public, including with the help of
they
the press.
They weren't illusions. They were falsehoods.
But we were complicit.
Absolutely.
The press was complicit in that.
We were afraid to be called the press. Un-American, unpatriotic, if we asked tough questions, challenging questions that we should have asked.
Do you think that George W. Bush understood all this? Do you he sort of has had a reputation for not necessarily being the brightest bulb on the tree, but there are a lot of people who dispute that and say, no, he's quite shrewd and he's quite bright. He just maybe lost his way in his presidency.
I don't think you have to be eloquent to know the difference between right and wrong. I think that he certainly was raised in a great household. He certainly would have known what was right and what was wrong. He should have reacted that way, but he didn't. I mean, we don't torture people. We don't invade countries that did nothing to us.
But that's, really, if you look at the history of, for instance, covert operations with Guatemala, you can list the countries, and you've been around for a lot of those circumstances over
this
the years.
This was an outright invasion, though. Guatemala, that's true. I certainly didn't approve of that. And the CIA doing its shenanigans all over the world that we are responsible for. I think it's wrong.
Here's a question from the audience that goes a little bit to that point. Where is the investigative reporting these days?
Pardon?
Where is the investigative reporting these days?
Gone forever.
Really?
Gone. They aren't willing to pay for it. The papers don't have the money, and it takes a lot of money. The Washington Post had 18 reporters on the Watergate scandal at the height of the exposure.
So you think that would just be, they don't have the staffs or they don't have the will these days to do that?
Well, money. It's the money. It takes a lot of money.
And what about...
a lot of time.
Are you paying attention to these other alternative forms that are springing up? ProPublica, for instance, has $30 million over 3 years from the Sandler family to do investigative reporting. In Berkeley, the Center for Investigative Reporting, full disclosure, I'm on the board of that, but,
you're trying just getting different models. Off the ground, though, aren't you, really?
Well, ProPublica is fairly new. CIR has been around for 30 years, although mm-hmm. we're now expanding it to try and fill some of the void that's been left by the cutbacks at mainstream media. But do you have some hope that some of these organizations are going to fill the gap that you're talking about?
Yes, I do. I hope. I have a lot of hope, and I do believe it's very necessary.
What should the Democratic Party's audience question do in the future about the so-called blue dogs?
Put them in the Republican Party. Who needs them?
So do you think Max Baucus was helpful to the process in the health care reform debate?
Hardly.
Here's another question from the audience. How free is our press today vis-a-vis network corporate ownership and their biases? How does money affect how free our press is?
I still think we have a free press, but there are many, many constraints, and it depends on how much the public wants a free press. If we all have to fall into the same line and so forth, and if you have to be patriotic, right or wrong, my country, may she always be right, but my country, right or wrong, then you have that attitude. And I think it's instilled in all of us.
Do you think it's really, but there's an issue here about who owns the press? Because, the press really, newspapers, for instance, wasn't that long ago where most newspapers were started by and or owned by people who had their own personal agendas and their own egos and their own interest in running for office and...
I never thought I'd say this, but I do long for the old family newspaper where the publisher, man or woman, made the money in real estate or mining or whatever. And the newspaper per se was their contribution to the community. They didn't expect to make a bonanza, which Wall Street demands now a 25% profit. That's unheard of. So in the good old days, I think they didn't expect to make that kind of profit. And I think they gave a lot of freedom to the newspapers.
Well, maybe there's hope, because most newspapers today are nonprofit, whether they like it or not.
Can't win.
You kind of answered this, but I'll ask it anyway, an audience question. You talked about Nixon and Clinton lying and George, too, using falsehoods. Which president had the most egregious lies?
I say I don't think compare a lie, really. Someone can be, I suppose you can in a sense, I'm contradicting myself. I think a lie that takes us into war, that's unnecessary, so many lives, that's egregious.
So lies are egregious, period. There's no rating of lies. We were talking actually a little bit before the event also about Glenn Beck and sort of the proliferation of people with opinion. And I'm not sure that one could actually say that people like Glenn Beck or even Rush Limbaugh necessarily present themselves as news people or as journalists. But this question goes to the point from the audience. How has Fox News and Rush Limbaugh, and I suspect we could add a number of other names, affected the political debate in Washington? How have they affected the political debate in Washington?
Oh, I think they're very effective. I think they're effective in the country, and I think they sway opinion a lot, to my sorrow.
And do you think that they're, I mean, I remember going to a dinner once some years ago, where right after Arianna Huffington had become a Democrat, and she was there, and I guess Larry David's wife, who was very active in the Democratic Party, and a number of people from the Clinton administration, and they were all bemoaning the fact that the world had gone to hell in a handbasket because Fox News, Rupert Murdoch ran the news, George Bush was president, and everything had gone away that they had believed in, and that they felt no handhold. And it struck me, and Norman Lear was there, and it struck me that in this room were people who probably, particularly Norman Lear, could put their finger on the pulse of culture and understand it, as he did for many years as a TV producer, and why they couldn't be more entertaining. I know that sounds shallow, but in a way, you know, Bill O'Reilly, one of the reasons he's popular is not simply because of his opinion, but he's also an entertainer. And I'm wondering whether you think that there's a quotient there when you talk about talk show hosts and cable television.
I think Maher is entertaining.
Bill Maher?
And yes, and he's very left.
So
liberal, that is.
There were years where left
and
was
John
really a dirty
Stewart
word.
And
it always struck me that people were worried about this notion that kids are getting their news from The Daily Show or The Colbert Show. And my own view about it is that The Daily Show really, I mean, the fundamental issue of The Daily Show is do not take public officials at their word. That's the underlying concept, which you'd probably agree with, wouldn't you?
I don't think they all lie. Maybe some. I'm a cynic with hope. And I don't, I think you always have to take people at their word until proved otherwise.
That's a lot of hope for someone who's seen 10 presidents. But here's a question from the audience about President Ford, who often doesn't get a lot of attention and a lot of ink, but you speak rather kindly of him in
yes.
your books. Can you speak a little bit about President Ford, how you saw him as both a person and as a president?
I thought he had a very tough job to step in after the Watergate scandal, and he did it so well. He stepped into the Oval Office. He brought respect back to the presidency. He said, the long national nightmare is over in terms of Watergate. So I think they really uplifted the whole White House again soon after the debacle of Watergate.
And personally, did you find him to be a decent,
wonderful
was sort of his image.
I think he was a wonderful man.
Would you say that about, what other presidents that you've covered would you say that about?
I don't worship at many shrines.
You also have written, as you have about all of them, about
you've been reading my mail.
if I could, I would, about LBJ. And you describe him as the most vulnerable president. And I think that probably some of us who sort of remember that era would be surprised, or are surprised that you know, we don't think of LBJ as a vulnerable. I mean, you listen to the tapes that came out later, and you see that he was a guy racked with doubt. But I don't think as a president we saw him as a particularly vulnerable human being.
He was very, very sensitive. He had a love-hate relationship with the press. He made the greatest contribution since FDR in the 20th century on the domestic side. He rammed through in his first 2 years in office Medicare, the Civil Rights Act, voting rights for blacks for the first time in the South, federal aid to education at all levels from Head Start through college, public housing, national parks, environmental laws. Nobody has matched that except for FDR. So I think that was great. But Vietnam was his denouement. He couldn't get out of it. He didn't want to be the first president, he said, to lose a war. He kept listening to the generals, and they kept disappointing him. And when Westmoreland, General Westmoreland, came and asked for 240,000 more troops, he knew it was all over. By this time, everyone was in the streets.
Right.
Hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?
And then there was that whole beagle with the ears thing that really hurt him. I've been reminded to remind our audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our speaker today is the legendary Washington journalist, Helen Thomas. We've talked about this a little bit, but here's an audience question. How do you feel about the proliferation of new online media and its place in society versus traditional media?
Well, I don't want to put newspapers out of business. I mean, the more we learn, the better off we are, obviously. But what are the checks on this new media mean for reliability, credibility?
So you feel like it's unfiltered by any sort of professional eye?
That's right.
I
think newspapers have great integrity. You tell a lie and put it on the front page, you're finished.
Well, I mean, I think we could look at the two major papers in the country, the Washington Post and the New York Times, and as you've suggested yourself, there have been times when they have not been reporting anything accurately. So that does happen, and it doesn't kill newspapers.
It does. I mean, you know what happens to reporters eventually.
So there's you feel that there's a check and balance system.
Because I do.
The press really doesn't have there's no higher authority, really, except the public.
That's right.
Here's a question from the audience. Have you ever been threatened, it says physically or other, about an article or story you've written or, I guess, were planning on writing?
Not really. I'm sure the thought has occurred to people.
This is a question I suspect that you get a fair amount. I know I get asked this occasionally. What would you advise a college student interested in a journalism major?
Go for it. The most exciting profession in the world. It's an education every day. You always keep learning. Very few professions give you that kind of latitude in life. That's what life is all about, is learning.
And so you would do that today if you were entering a professional field, you would consider journalism. Would you worry about whether you could be supported by it?
Sure. I cannot tell a lie.
Well, in that case, let's ask some more questions here. You mentioned the vast right-wing conspiracy when it came to Clinton. I think you used it you've used it in quotes. But you have said, including today, that you felt that the right really went after him mercilessly.
Oh, without a doubt.
This question from a member of the audience. What do you think caused the right to target President Clinton?
Republicans had held the White House for 12 years, and they didn't want to give it up. And they gave no legitimacy to Clinton as a result. I think it was too tough for them. They thought they owned the White House. I know that's a glib answer, but that's, I truly believe it.
So it was entitlement. They just felt a sense of entitlement.
That's right.
Here's a question that I should have asked myself, but here's a member of the audience asking. Would you consider running for president in 2012?
If elected, I will serve.
You know what? I think we just made news here. There are a lot of questions. Again, this is San Francisco, so it's not that surprising that they would. Have you ever seen such anger and hatred displayed by a political party? And is the media partly responsible for this venom? I'm clearly talking about Republican Party, I would assume, the person who asked the question.
I think we have one of the worst climates of hate today. It's overwhelming, and it's very unfair. It's frightening in a way. Hate, really dispensing hate with underlying themes and so forth. I think it's been perpetuated by people who don't understand how dangerous a situation they have created. Hate.
Well, in your career, how have you seen that manifested?
I think this is the worst of the times, really. The worst. Fear and hate. That's not us.
And the antidote, what do you think? I mean, you're not the President of the United States yet, but...
How do you know?
Well, that would be even bigger news.
Antidote is, I think, just telling people the truth, playing it straight, really taking care of the fears and worries in this country, which is prosperity, war, health care, all of these things that need immediate attention. I think that our values have to be sustained. And I can't believe that people would deny anybody medicine in this country. And good care.
Well, these are also complex issues, as you've noted yourself in your book advising future presidents. I mean, none of them are simple. They have to work within this system. So is it really the system that has become, you know, pitted with bad feelings and bad intentions? Is it really the system that makes this climate possible?
I think a true leader can rise above it. Really go to the people and explain exactly what it's all about and what it means. And that's what leadership is all about.
And who have you observed who's done that most effectively as President of the United States?
I think Roosevelt in World War II. I think Johnson, many occasions where he tried to sell the Great Society against a lot of opposition from the American Medical Association and so forth, against Medicare. How many years? I mean, Truman first proposed it. And President Johnson went to Truman's home in Independence, Missouri, to sign the first Medicare bill. And Truman was standing by the desk, and Johnson was sitting at Truman's desk. He signed the bill, and Max Frankel, who was a reporter at the White House, he later became executive editor at the New York Times. He was a New York Times reporter, went up to Johnson, and he said, "Mr. President," after he signed the Medicare bill, "my mother thanks you." And Johnson said, "You should thank me."
You're taking
take the burden off.
Do you think that Ronald Reagan, I mean, again, maybe not popular in this particular city, but he certainly changed things dramatically during his presidency. Would you consider him in that?
I think Mrs. Reagan was a big help on that. I think she was really, she told him to go to Moscow, to talk to Gorbachev, to open the doors. And it was against, really, most of his advisors didn't say that. They were hardliners, and Nancy Reagan was a heroine, in my opinion.
Interesting. You know, there's a story at the time that she was consulting a psychic here in San Francisco for a lot of these issues. Do you remember reading that story?
Yeah.
You think that was an unfair hit on Nancy Reagan?
I don't know if it was unfair. Maybe I'd consult all the gods if I were in that position. I remember when we went to, when Nancy Reagan really urged her husband to go to Moscow to talk to Gorbachev, open the doors, and Soviet Union. And when we got there, President Reagan was, his eyes opened. He said he found the Russians laughed, they cried, they were human. And when we came back to Washington, I said to him, Mr. President, do you think maybe if you had gone to Moscow 10 years ago, 20 years ago, you might have found out that the Russians laugh, they cry, they're human? He said, nope, they changed.
That's a
Cold War.
That's right. That's a your view of Nancy Reagan is really fascinating. It strikes me also that Pat Nixon had to have been, in not necessarily the traditional way, but in many ways, the longest suffering political wife. I mean, he just seems so dark and complicated.
To be evicted from the White House, she was a wonderful woman.
Can you just talk a little bit about her?
I think she was very misunderstood. She was called Plastic Pat, which was not true. She was warm and human and kind and opened the doors of the White House wider to volunteers and to people. I think she was a very tragic figure.
I remember when she died that seeing him weep uncontrollably at her funeral was shocking because, you know, I, like a lot of people, and that growing up then, developed an idea of Richard Nixon that he was pretty
He realized his loss.
Do you think finally then?
Yes, I think that you take each other for granted, and I think they didn't. I think they loved each other and so forth, but he was so distracted.
And we all, you know, have to deal with sacrifice in our professions, presidents and first ladies probably more than most, but do you think in your own life that there are things that you've had to sacrifice to be such a devoted and dedicated journalist?
No. I've enjoyed it.
Can I get a follow-up question on that? Now, it was George Bush, George W., who would not allow follow-up questions, right? Did that change, or did it stick?
It hasn't changed much. I think you kind of force it sometimes. You stand there and insist on it, but it doesn't come easy with them, and you always have to have a follow-up because you want to say why.
Well, it strikes me as I watch some of the videos of you that you asked the follow-up whether they allowed it or not. So, what kind of president?
Great country.
And we need to be reminded of that, I think, regularly. Question from the audience: what kind of president do you think Hillary Clinton would have made?
Tough. I think she would have been good. I think she's very competent and so forth. I think she would have been a good president.
Her husband has gotten an extraordinary amount of press that I would call the cultural variety, sort of dissecting his personality. And Vanity Fair, which likes to use this word a lot, has referred to him as a great narcissist. You talk about the ego is required to just run for president, to even seek the office.
I think so.
Do you think that Clinton had a larger ego than, let's say, other presidents? You don't like to rank lies, but you rank egos?
No, I think they all have big egos. That even to imagine to be president of the United States, I mean, to aspire to it.
Here's an audience question. What's your favorite question that you've ever asked a president? That's been... Probably have a few.
That's a really tough one. Why did you run? I don't know. That came off the top. It's very hard.
Who did you ask that of?
Pardon?
Who did you ask that of?
I didn't ask it.
Oh, you didn't ask. Okay, all right. That's just one you would have liked to have asked.
I have wondered, though.
Somebody noted that you played yourself in movies like Dave, and they wondered what the experience was like.
It was fun. But I found out, you know, Hurry Up and Wait was the same modus operandi as being waiting outside for VIP to come out of the White House for hours in the rain and so forth. Takes a long time to be in the movies. I had one line. Well, but I got more running out of that than 50 years of reporting. Haven't I seen you in the movies?
Given the gender issues that you've dealt with, this is another audience question, what was the single most, if you can say, the single most event or characteristic that pushed you through the glass ceiling in your career?
Well, I was not alone. Women were really feeling put upon of being deprived of being able to perform their own professions in all medicine, law, certainly journalism. I think that just the whole idea of the unfairness of it all.
Do you think that there still exists in the press a sort of hierarchy?
Sure.
And how would you describe it?
Well, I think it was always a man's world, and it's very hard to get them to step down.
Where exactly would you like to see them step? Where exactly would you like to see them step down? And which ones?
Are you a victim?
I'm asking the questions. All right.
I ask the questions.
I surrender. All right. Unfortunately, we have reached the time in our program, and very unfortunate because really I'm having a great time listening to you, and I think everyone else is. We have one last question, and I'm trying to pick which one. I already should have picked it, but let's ask this. What advice do you have for the next generation of White House political journalists and the editors looking to cultivate them?
And the
editors looking to cultivate them.
I think that they should understand what the role of journalism is, and that is to seek the truth and let the chips fall where they may. That's always been our thesis. It's never changed. Times don't change the seeking of truth.
And but truth is hard to find sometimes, very hard to find, particularly when you have a whole power structure devoted to obscuring the truth.
But in the end, you can find it if you really try.
Well, on that very optimistic note, I want to give a great thanks to Helen Thomas, veteran Washington journalist.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Can I take them home with me?
You can take them all with you.
You're all wonderful. Thank
author,
you so much.
Author of the new book, Listen Up, Mr. President. We want to thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. And please remember that Ms. Thomas will be signing books in the lobby. So if you could please allow her to get out there before everybody rushes out, that would be great. And I think I have to say something else. I'm Phil Bronstein. This meeting, the Commonwealth Club of California, celebrating more than a century of enlightened discussion, is adjourned. Thank you very much.